never seen you looking so lovely as you did tonight. I've never seen you shine so bright.
In this week's Songs of Praise, a special guest will be sharing the secrets of his success. He's sold over 45 million albums worldwide and has 200 platinum discs, one of which, Lady in Red, made him an international star. He's very proud of the Christian faith, which continues to inspire him. Tonight, Chris de Burgh sings some old favourites and talks about faith, family and music.
Lady in Red is dancing with me.
A self-taught musician, Chris studied French and Spanish at Trinity College in Dublin after boarding at Marlborough College. And sees himself today as both composer and storyteller.
The most striking thing about your songs is the stories.
I think that kind of started with a seminal moment in my second album, which was called Spanish Train and Other Stories. And the title song tells this dramatic tale of a cosmic struggle between the God and the devil, and the devil cheats. Based, I think, curiously enough, on John Milton's Paradise Lost. And from then on, I really enjoyed writing stories.
Globally, too, you've been very popular. In Germany, for instance.
Germany, very big country.
You've done very well indeed. And the Berlin Wall, the time of the Berlin Wall, you were there in what was a tremendously historic and emotional night.
It was basically the marriage between East and West Germany. Chancellor Kohl had invited me as the sort of international guest to come and sing Borderline, which is a song I wrote basically looking at the obscenity of war.
These are only boys and I will never know how men can see the wisdom in a war.
That gets huge applause everywhere I sing it. It always gives me the chills. And at the stroke of midnight, I sang that, which was televised all over the world, and there were 3 million people in the center of Berlin around the Brandenburg Gate where I was singing. And it was just absolutely extraordinary. One of those moments in my career I'll never forget.
Can't you call me, but I wanna be with you.
Behold the life that I did shall be.
Born in Argentina in 1948, Chris has made his home in Ireland for the past 45 years and now lives in the Wicklow Mountains, south of Dublin.
So this is your family church? This is where you bring the gang, is it?
Absolutely. This is St Patrick's Enniskerry. We come here whenever we can, and there's a nice feeling about this, very good community spirit here.
Is worship itself important to you, wherever it is?
Well, I think you can do it just about anywhere, in a field, wherever you feel comfortable. But the nice thing about a place like this is it's a sense of community, a sense of belonging, people that you don't see that often, and particularly to bring your family here and to worship and, you know, just join the Christian spirit.
It's a lovely place, isn't it?
Beautiful.
Some of your songs, Chris, are very spiritual and actually overtly Christian, like Risen Lord, for instance, that we're going to hear. I mean, what is the source of that?
Well, the Risen Lord came from very much the feeling of the road to Damascus, and based on the idea that you should be kind to strangers because you never know, it might be Jesus himself. And I had this feeling, as the first words came out, "A brother, could you spare me food and give me a drink of wine?" This is somebody who has been traveling on a road and has helped somebody who has stumbled and fallen, and then has taken up this person's burden. And as they have walked, the burden became heavier and heavier, almost as if it came from another world. And it became a very strong visual and Christian image for me.
Brother, can you spare me food and give me a drink of wine? I've been traveling on this road for such a long, long time. I have seen the wonders, but most amazing of them all, I believe I've seen the face of the risen Lord. On a night like this, there came a stranger on the road. I heard him stumble, saw him fall, I helped him with his load. The further that we walked, well, the heavier it became. And I believe I felt the weight from another world.
When he started school, Chris's parents worked in Africa, and so from the age of six, he was sent to a boarding school in Ireland.
Good morning, Chris.
Sally Magnusson.
How are you? You're very welcome. Lovely to see you. Chris,
Kevin,
great to see you. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Great setting, isn't it?
Beautiful, absolutely gorgeous. And for me, it brings back extraordinary memories of my children being here. They used to come into school just around there every day when I dropped them. And in summertime, playing on the banks and playing football and tennis and cricket and rugby and the whole thing.
No wonder you like being in school, right?
I love it.
Hear the voices in the classroom, singing in my.
Chris, why does this school matter so much to you?
I went to Aravan School, a different location, closer to the town of Bray, at the age of 6 3/4, boarding, because my parents were in Africa at the time.
Boarding at six?
Yeah, it was a bit on the young side.
What was that like for you, six years old?
It was difficult. Apparently, at the time, they used to have the tallest boy in the school was the school elephant, and the school ant was the smallest, and I was the school ant. Not much bigger, isn't it? Still, eh?
What effect did that have on you, though, emotionally?
Well, hard to say, really, but I do think it's difficult when you're that little and not have the cuddles that you'd naturally get from your mother and father. I think I'm compensating by being extremely affectionate with my own children.
That's interesting. So it hasn't actually made you hold things within yourself. It's actually encouraged you to be more...
The absolute opposite, yeah. I tend to release my emotions. And this school brings that out very strongly in me. This is a song I wrote, a different look at the Christmas story. Imagine for a moment that the Star of Bethlehem that hung over the stable where Christ lay, that was guiding the three wise men to see where baby Jesus was in fact a spacecraft from another galaxy, from another world, bringing the good news of Christ's birth from somewhere completely different across the universe and joining in the celebrations that we know now as Christmas. This is called A Spaceman Came Traveling.
A spaceman came traveling on his ship from afar. 'Twas light years of time since his mission did start. And over a village he halted his craft, and it hung in the sky like a star. Just like a star. He followed a light and came down to a shed, where a mother and child were lying there on a bed. A bright light of silver shone round his head, and he had the face of an angel. And they were afraid. Then the stranger spoke. He said, "Do not fear. I come from a planet a long way from here, and I bring a message for mankind to hear." And suddenly the sweetest music filled the air, and it went la 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 la. Peace and goodwill to all men, and love for the child. To all men, and love for
So where have you brought me now?
This is Colemore Harbour in the village of Dorkey, where I lived with my family for 16 years. And this is a favourite little walk of mine. I like the sea very much. It represents freedom, freedom of thought, freedom of dreams. It's very spectacular. Behind me is Dorkey Island, where there was a very early Christian settlement, about 8th or 9th century. It's a great place for reflection, for inspiration, and I used to come down here in all weathers.
You grew up in a castle, didn't you? It sounds a bit grand, but I gather it wasn't really.
My grandfather bought the place because we didn't have the money. My father had this crazy idea to live in a castle, and when we moved in, there was no heat, no light, no furniture, no water, and it was very cold indeed.
Colder than this?
Much colder than this. We had to sleep in our clothes. And, you know, the family worked very hard. We opened a small hotel in the summer, which is where I learned to sing to the guests. The poor things, they had nowhere else to go at night, so I pulled out the guitar and sang. And we also ran a farm, varied, you know, sheep, cattle. And I very strongly and very quickly learned the process of being part of nature and getting very mucky, you know, mud, blood, and everything that goes with a farm. And I think it's stood for me, and I owe it to my parents and their strength to give me the strength to take everything that comes my way, because my career is one built on disappointments, even now.
You've always been happy to describe yourself as a Christian. What is God to you?
God is a comfort. God is an entity that surrounds us. I think the biggest problem that we have, and I'm speaking for myself, I suppose, as well, is that we just don't listen. God is all-encompassing. It makes me joyful to know that there is a God out there. Of that, I've total, absolute, firm conviction.
Restless hearts, it has been a long time out here on the journey for a glimpse of paradise. It's getting hard to find a place to go where peaceful waters flow. I took a walk past the old Saxon well, down by the cathedral I heard the chapel bell, and I joined the people singing for a way to go where peaceful waters flow. And if you don't know by now, you never will. Only love can find the door. And if you could see it now, it's in your hand. Only love can reach the shore to heaven. Always you are standing by my side. You're my inspiration and you're my battle cry, and in your arms is the only place I know where peaceful waters flow. And if you don't know, can reach the shore forevermore.
After leaving school in Ireland, Chris went on to study for his A-levels at Marlborough College, where he learned to play guitar. Today, it's a very different school to the one Chris remembers from his time there in the early 1960s.
And this is the music wing.
Fantastic, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Apparently the swimming pool was here. I kind of prefer the music because it was a cold pool. What have we got in here?
Would you like something like this?
Oh, yeah.
What do you make of this?
Isn't this beautiful?
Some place.
Absolutely gorgeous. It's bringing back an avalanche of memories.
What do you remember?
Well, I remember when I came here first, I was very subdued because it's an enormous place, not what I was used to back home. And I grew into it, and right now, things catch my... For example, this picture. I must have sat many, many times looking at that one. It really struck my imagination, this city living on a cloud.
What else? All these panels.
Yeah.
There's your Siegfried Sassoon. He was a bit of a hero of yours, wasn't he?
Siegfried?
Mm-hmm.
I loved his war poems. They had a huge effect on my songwriting. For example, in the memorial tablet, Squire nagged and bullied till I went to fight under Lord Derby's scheme. I died in hell.
Yes, I'm well, but this place is like hell. They call it Passchendaele.
My wound was slight, and I was hobbling back, and then a shell burst slick upon the duckboards, so I fell into the bottomless mud and lost the fight. At sermon time, while Squire is in his pew, he gives my gilded name a thoughtful stare, for though low down upon the list, I'm there. In proud and glorious memory, that's my due. 2 bleeding years I fought in France for Squire. I suffered anguish that he has never guessed. Once I came home on leave and then went west. What greater glory could a man desire?
We'll be together in this song for you.
What about this?
It's fantastic, isn't it? Absolutely fantastic. It brings back extraordinary memories of sitting down the aisle on these pews and looking up at these angels and this beautiful, beautiful altar area. Stunning.
Are they happy memories of your school here, though?
Yes, they are. This was a place of discovery. I was becoming a young man. I came here at the age of 12, and although I was living in Ireland at the time, a boarder, I did enjoy it, the rough and tumble of boarding school. And I mean, even on filthy wet days, we'd be out playing rugby and we'd be worshipping here, I believe, certainly every morning. And we went to another church in the Marlborough Main Street on Sundays. I mean, there were sad times as well and lonely times, but I learned to be very, very self-sufficient. My brother had gone to another school, and so I was kind of on my own. But I got on very well here, and I enjoyed it. And it's lovely coming back.
And you became, ultimately, quite close to your father, didn't you?
Yeah. My relationship with my mum and dad. My mum, it's always been great. My father was a little more awkward, I think they often are, between fathers and sons, something I've often written about in my songs and referred to it in, like, the son and the father, the words I love you, and so on. But a rapprochement came towards the end of his life, and I have to say it was a bizarre thing to admit, but to say the words I love you was very, very hard for me, and I remember seeing him outside this old Norman castle I was brought up in, sitting outside in the morning sun, and he'd not been well, and I went up to him and I hugged him and I said, Dad, I love you. And even now it
there are those who think that
But we know from those around us that this may not always be. It's the simple things that come between a father and their son. But when they try to talk, the knives are out before they have begun. Well, that was me, and I have seen the light that shines for eternity, because I learned to say the words I love you. So many hearts have been broken by the lies of history, and so many arms are still open for that final mystery. We must show respect for all the rest and what a man believes, and the one who died upon the cross, well, he is the one for me. And he says,
how much this place has affected me until really a short time ago when I walked in. And it's just like a moment of complete, wow, this is where it all began. I took in so much power and energy and love and belief and compassion from being in this school and being around people who thought the same way as I did. You see, okay, we were made to come here, you know, on a daily basis, but I loved coming here. And can you imagine 600 or 800 voices singing something like Jerusalem, full throttle, like, and did those feet in ancient times walk upon England's mountains green?
Yeah.
I've always believed that I have to be two people. One is the ordinary guy at home, and the other person is the fellow on the stage and on the TV. And when Rosanna won the Miss World competition, she agreed with that. She understood it. She's the girl that slops around in slippers and dressing gown at home and then looks extremely glamorous when she goes out into the public arena. And of course, I'm highly proud of my little girl, who's no longer little.
Are you two quite close then? I get the sense that you are. Really.
I think we are. It helps that I still live at home. Yeah. But we've always been a close family. I have two little brothers who get on well together and who are close to...
Well, that must be unique.
Yeah,
it is. Two brothers that get on well together?
They have their annoying moments. But yeah, we've always had a good relationship, and Mum included. He's given as much time as possible, you know, with his busy career and his travelling. He's always compensated for the time he's spent away working hard.
Well, I was going to ask you about that because, I mean, you must travel a lot, Chris, and that can mean that you don't see as much of your children as you might have wanted.
Yeah, it's the most difficult balance of all, trying to balance family life and the requirements of a career. At least at this stage of my career, I can choose what I want to do. I suppose it goes into my own personal background, and I want to be there for my kids as much as possible, and Diane as well, and just kind of be the man around the house. Instead of constantly touring, I know exactly what my priorities are, and my main priority is my family.
I've never seen so many people want to be there by your side, and when you turn to me and smile, it took my breath up.
The big hit, of course, Lady in Red.
Yeah.
That made you a household name, didn't it?
Certainly in my house, yeah. Some people find it just, romantic dross, to be honest, and other people love it.
Lady in Red.
I was laughing my head off one year because they had these lists of, you know, most adored songs, most hated, and Lady in Red was in both their top fives. But that was about relationships and how you can't just expect a relationship, once you've got it together, just to stay that way. It's always in a period of flux. So a relationship in Lady in Red, for example, was about two people who had been together for a while, and clearly this man has been seeing this lady many, many times in different ways, you know, different styles, different clothes, and he's seen something that night that really made him stand up, because men are hopeless about remembering what, you know, their women folk wear. And this one, he's just really reacting to something he's seen that night.
Of all the songs that you've written, what's the one that most expresses who you are?
You know, funnily enough, I've never wanted to reveal too much of who I really am. I'm as guarded as the next person. I don't want to go too deep in public. I always have a wall around my emotions, but I would suppose there's one song called Where We Will Be Going that probably would sum up, certainly the first verse, my beliefs and the energy I receive from being alive on this planet. In fact, I have a guitar here.
You have a guitar?
Curiously enough, just to my left-hand side, I shall pick it up.
You have been thoughtfully prepared before the programme began.
This is borrowed from a student here at Marlborough College. I'll see how this is.
I got every reason to be high. I got a place in the heaven beyond. I got dreams to live and I've got love to give. And I know it in my heart and soul, where we will be going. Where we will be going.
And where are you going?
I'm going on this journey of my life, this road, with all the things that can go right and go wrong, the things that flow smoothly, and the things that require you to stand up and make a good fight of it.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me, the quiet waters by.
Next week, TV architect Maxwell Hutchison is in London, where Songs of Praise will have a distinctly 17th and 18th century flavour. There'll be a performance from St Paul's Cathedral Choir as he takes us on a church crawl to discover some of the capital's hidden gems, Sir Christopher Wren's City Churches.